So anyway, my name is Robert Grillo, and I'm the founder and director of Free From Harm, which is a nonprofit that I founded in 2009, dedicated to farm animal rescue, education, and advocacy. And we do very little rescue, but the rescue we do is very important to the stories and who we are and what we do with those rescue stories. We broadcast them online, and in 2014, we reached 6 million people through Facebook and Twitter and our web presence. We reached 6 million web users with these stories, so with the message of farm animal rescue, education, and advocacy. So they're very important to us. I'm here today with a presentation that I've been working on for about the last 3.5 years. I call it Fictions, Facts, and Food Choices, and I have two different versions of it. I'm going to give you the one today that's basically geared towards a general public audience, but I also have one that I developed for more of an animal advocacy audience. Unfortunately, that one's a little bit too long for this of time frame that we have today, and I want to make sure that we get room for Q&A. So I'm giving the general public one, but I still think there's a lot of value for animal advocates in this. So without any further ado, Fictions, Facts, and Food Choices is about exploring the powerful influences that manipulate and shape our beliefs about animals and about food, and also the choices and decisions that stem from those beliefs. I'm a firm believer that we don't just make decisions willy-nilly, we make them based on deeply held, deeply entrenched beliefs. And that's what this presentation is about exploring. So to start out with, I'd like to tell you a little bit about my background. For the last 20 years, I've been in the creative fields as a marketing communications professional. And I got a start working at different agencies around Chicago, freelancing here and there. And Chicago has this reputation for having a lot of food industry accounts. And at one point in my early career as a young man, younger man, I found myself working on things like this Happy Meal box, believe it or not. So I've come a long way. This isn't like a proud part of my past, but there's a silver lining to having worked on a Happy Meal box. But at the time, I never saw a problem with the portrayal of happy farm animals on the package containing the body parts of animals that likely lived miserable lives. And it never occurred to me that there might be a problem with the mixed messages that we're sending children, or how children would be traumatized to actually learn the truth about the process by which this food came into this box. Now, around 2009, a lot changed for me. I saw films like Food Inc., and I impulsively adopted these three little ones from a chick hatching program. And I knew nothing about raising chickens at the time, and I had to quickly teach myself how you raise them and how you care for babies, baby chicks. And they just became like family to me. All of them are no longer with us. The oldest one lived 5.5 years. But the experience was life-changing for me. Everything I had been taught about chickens was completely wrong. Like, they're totally different than what we think. And I was so moved by the fact that there's this huge disparity between what we're taught and what popular culture teaches us about farmed animals like chickens and what they're really like. I felt compelled to become an activist and to become an educator. And so I like to start things out by kind of putting back a question to my audience, because I think we need to get back to to really understand this, we need to get back to the source of things and think about our childhood. I like to ask people if they can think of whether they were, you know, there were experiences in their childhood with adults where they were taught not to care about farmed animals, about chickens, turkeys, cows, and pigs specifically. I know that as a child, I was told things by the adult world like, well, you know, if I showed a concern about eating animals or farm animals, the response from the adult world is generally, don't worry about it, you know? It's part of the natural cycle, or it's just the way things are, or that's what they're here for, or, you know, as a rite of passage into adulthood, we have to accept the way things are and not question them. It's like there's a process of stifling any critical thought, any critical thinking about farmed animals, and it's drummed into us as children. Grow up, toughen up. So think about that. If you can think of any events in your childhood while we're giving this presentation, if you can think of any that may have influenced you, or even children's literature and movies as well. What I've found through my research and work that I'm doing is that our culture conditions us to ignore the one daily decision, well, three meals, the three daily decisions that by far have the greatest impact on animals and our environment and our health, of course. To illustrate this point, consider the fact that farmed animals represent at least 99%, if not 99.7%, of all of the animals that are bred into this world for human use. And the other, all the other uses, animals used in testing, in hunting, fishing, I'm sorry, actually we're not including fish in this, or fishing. But all the other ones used in hunting, testing laboratories, circuses, for fashion, for education, like the chicks that I rescued from a chick hatching program, all of those other uses represent only 0.3%. So the question that I struggle with on a daily basis and have for years now is how is it possible that this conditioning can work so well on so many of us and for so long in our lives? It took me well into my 40s to have any kind of awareness about this. And I felt like I was blind to it for the vast majority of my life. I'm glad I got a laugh out of that. Wasn't intended, but that's fine. I'm glad that it is kind of funny in a way. The Matrix is a story from popular culture that has a very different kind of message. It is not the kind of message that we normally hear, which is, you know, I'm here to entice you into buying my product because you're addicted to whatever it is I'm selling you. The Matrix actually is asking us to question what we've been taught and to look critically at the world. That there's illusion in every corner. There's a house of mirrors, and then there's another room of mirrors. And so we need to look critically at things. And there's an ultimatum that's very important to the plot of The Matrix, which is the red pill or blue pill choice. The choice between truth and fiction. And that's incredibly relevant, and it's actually central to this subject. Because the blue pill, when it comes to animals and eating animals, serves two critically important functions. And the first one is that, we overwhelmingly as a society take the blue pill over the red pill. Some of us have taken the red pill, but most of us take the blue pill because it tells us what we want to hear and it shows us what we want to see. It's what we want to believe. We want to believe that farm animals have been well cared for and suffer minimally in the short time that they're allowed to stay alive on farms. We really want to believe that. So taking the blue pill helps us in that pursuit. And the second important function that taking the blue pill is that it advances the agenda of animal agriculture, of the animal exploitation industries, by presenting animals as willing participants in whatever it is that we'd like to do to them. Now, how they do this is through storytelling, primarily. There is an art and science to storytelling, and it has ancient roots. It's been used before we had written languages, before civilization, when storytelling was just oral, passed down orally from one generation to another. Important ideas were embedded in these stories. And the reason why they were fictionalized is because we think that people, it makes sense that, you know, we want children to listen to these stories, so we make them fictional and interesting, and we just kind of pepper them and embed them with important ideas so that they too will then pass them on to the next generation. And in exploring the subject of storytelling, and how it intersects with our culture and the power that it has, I came across a very important thinker named Antonio Gramsci. And Gramsci was a young man imprisoned by Mussolini. He grew up in fascist Italy, and he was the leading anti-fascist intellectual at the time. And he spent years suffering in prison. But rather than languishing in a prison cell, he was actually writing thousands of pages of manuscript that would later become some of the most important work on social change, on how change happens and how society moves out of a fascist era into a social democrat Europe. So he has incredibly important importance even today in that area of social change. One of the concepts he introduced that I want to just focus on today is called cultural hegemony. You might also think of it as cultural tyranny. In other words, controlling the control of culture. Gramsci defined cultural hegemony as the domination and manipulation of society's norms, habits, customs, values, beliefs, through story and fiction telling to promote the dominant class's worldview as normal, the powers that be and what they want to do as the normal, society's normal. It's a lot like what we call popular culture today. So an example of this in Gramsci's time, in the fascist era, there were lots of different types of propaganda used at the time. It became very sophisticated under the fascist regimes. One of those programs was known as the euthanasia, or mercy killing program, as it was called. And it portrayed images like this one of concentration camp children who were well-dressed and shown well-fed and cleaned up and singing patriotic songs to the international press. This is the side of reality that the fascists wanted the world, the international press, to see. And of course, the world later learned that the reality was that this was happening, of course. And at a certain point, they instituted gassing as a form of extermination, and they were promoting it as humane. It was a very important concept. Humane relative to what, you might ask? Well, we won't get into that, but today there's a striking parallel in this use of propaganda by animal agriculture. It's called humane washing. Like greenwashing, humane washing shows us feel-good images of happy family farmers, like this one. And it tells us feel-good fictions and fantasies about happy animals that are happy about being serving us and happy to go violently to their deaths just to satisfy our taste buds. But the Oh, that is a stun gun. It's a captive bolt pistol. It sends a bolt through the skull of the animal. The fact is that the reality is that animals' lives are drastically and violently cut short in their infancy or adolescence. And of course, it's not done out of necessity. This is just a way of life. This is how some people make a living. But of course, this part of the reality is hidden from us. And that's how humane washing works. Now, you might wonder why I'm comparing the fascist era with today. I think where these two intersect is that they both use propaganda successfully to conceal a systematic form of violence and oppression against an inferior group who's considered inferior, and who are sacrificed in the name of some benefit to a superior group. And in both cases, what Gramsci calls cultural hegemony becomes toppled, it's disempowered when society's collective silence, denial, and defensiveness is challenged and overcome by the facts of the matter, right? And you might say in both cases, when truth prevails over fictions, justice prevails over injustice. And that's what we hope to see for animals at some point in the future. Let's take a moment just to appreciate and recognize the power of the influences that I'm talking about and about to show you examples. Consider that the fact that Cargill, which is the largest, one of the largest food corporate food entities in the world, in animal agriculture, just in 2012 spent $1,792,000,000 just on promoting animal products to consumers. That is not their net worth. That is not the profit. I repeat, that is their advertising budget for the year. Okay. So let's look at some of the most common fictional devices that animal agriculture uses to condition people and manipulate our beliefs. But before we do that, actually, let's just look at a few things that we know about animals that we know are true, so that the fictions will look even more bizarre when we know some basic facts. And these are facts that we generally agree on, okay? So a couple of years ago, the Cambridge Declaration of Animal Consciousness was published. It was signed by over 400 some of the world's leading neuroscientists and animal behaviorists. And it was basically a very broad statement about the fact that mammals, all birds, and all fish, and some non-vertebrates are all sentient in the same manner as humans are, and they have a certain level that define certain levels of consciousness. But just in general, you know, common sense tells us that an animal that is in a complex ecosystem that has to function in a complex ecosystem has to have a mind to navigate its way through that life in that complex ecosystem. And it involves finding a mate and building shelters and giving birth and finding and storing food for their family and raising and educating their young, negotiating and communicating with others in a large social group, learning from past experiences and applying what they've learned to future events, and experiencing and expressing likes, dislikes, pains, pleasures, loves, and losses. We know from scientific studies that chickens are self-aware, and they compare themselves with other chickens, other individual chickens in their flock, and that they see themselves as having certain roles within that flock. We know that fish are sentient, and sentient in the same way as mammals and birds. They have the same brain hardwiring for pain perceptions and emotions. It's called the limbic system of the brain. We know from a famous study that's ongoing at University of Chicago, that lab rats helped other lab rats that were caged out of a cage and spent tirelessly days, in some cases, trying to free the other rat. And then once they were free, they celebrated with sharing all the treats that they got. But, you know, broadly speaking, we should also just recognize that since the age of Darwin and evolutionary biology, this is our way of understanding and gaining knowledge about the human mind and behavior and all of the animals. And we're part of a continuum. Darwin and everything that has come after that is about breaking this false dichotomy between us and them. It doesn't exist. We're on a continuum with other species. And if we survive, there may very well be another species after Homo sapien that we could consider more evolved than ourselves. So, with that said, let's dive into some of these fictional devices. The first big one I would like to talk about is called consent. consent is portraying animals as willing participants in whatever it is that we'd like to do with them. This is an example of a very iconic kind of image of Krishna, the Lord Krishna, milking a sacred cow. And you can see how consensual and benevolent this depiction is, right? And it's hauntingly similar to this Organic Valley milk packaging, the same kind of benevolent master caring for his animals and the children, showing, teaching the children to be kind to animals, and of course masking everything else that's unpleasant that happens to the animals that are raised for milk. It's very important to understand that these fictions aren't anything new. Like I said before, even in the age of oral storytelling, these fictions started to evolve. And there's a continuum here between ancient and modern, like you see in the visual that I just gave you. We portray ourselves as the benevolent masters of animals. We define their existence as the extent to which they're useful to us. And our language affirms this kind of relationship with them. We never say we take things from animals. We never say we take their eggs or their milk or their bodies or their lives. We say they give it to us. That's a very important distinction. They make a sacrifice for us. It's an anthropomorphic belief. We say that they're doing something for us, and it's basically giving them human qualities to justify what we'd like to do with them. Now, another big fictional device that is very important to social psychologist Melanie Joy, some of you might know, is invisibility. And it's the idea that we rarely see farm animals, and we rarely see who are being misrepresented by all these fictions because they're conveniently hidden from view. Consider the fact that at any given time, there's about 32 farm animals being bred into existence for every American. There's 32 farm animals somewhere. But you got to think about, you don't see too many farm animals on a daily basis, at least most of us don't. But we see a lot of humans, you know, on TV and in person. We rarely see farm animals. So invisibility plays a very important function in legitimizing this whole process. Another important fictional device is anonymity. So when they're not invisible, when we actually do see portrayals of them, they're usually caricatures, like this Ben and Jerry's ad. They're portrayed as nameless and faceless and generic and lacking any differentiating or unique characteristics. Objectification is another important fictional device. It's about transforming animals, animal victims, into objects. We handle a baby chick in the same way that we handle a beer bottle, to take the cap off of a beer bottle. We handle her the same way to take her beak, the edge of her beak off, so that she won't peck at other chicks in an intensely confined free-range environment. Quote from Karen Davis, author and activist, which I think speaks to this really well, is, if you want to hurt someone and maintain a clean conscience about it, chances are you will invoke arguments along one or more of these lines. The victim doesn't feel, doesn't know, doesn't care, is complicit, or isn't even there. Oh, absolutely, because the fact that they're in a free-range environment is the whole purpose of debeaking them. It's a cheap way of keeping them from hurting each other because of the fact that they're living in way too crowded conditions. They're very stressed out in these conditions, and they start fighting for space. Chickens like privacy. They don't get any privacy in these kinds of environments, so they get stressed and they start pecking at each other. So another fictional device is related to objectification. I call it commodification. This photo was taken by me at a farmer's market in Marin County when I was there a couple years ago. We were at a farmer's market with all this beautiful produce, and then in the back there's this cage full of these beautiful baby chicks. And there's a sign on top of it that says $2 each. So that's the value that farmers put on these animals. They're worth $2. A whole lifetime of experience is worth less than the price of a tube of toothpaste. I mean, think about that for a minute. So we know certain things about chicks. They're incredibly precocious learners. And right out of the shell, they have a sense of geometry and physics and spatial understanding that doesn't develop in human minds until toddler age, typically. There were some pretty famous studies that came out last year about this. We know that right out of the shell, chicks seek to imprint on their mother. And they seek the mother's love and nurturing, and the mother teaches them important life skills, like finding food and avoiding predators and these kinds of things. But today, thanks to artificial incubation, which actually goes all the way back to ancient Egypt, today, chicks are intentionally raised as orphans without mothers. They will never know their mothers, and their mothers will never know their young. We've completely broken the family unit so we can maximize egg production. And for every female that we saw at this farmer's market, there was a male that was killed, destroyed at a hatchery in the most inhumane, obscene way possible by sorting them out at hatcheries and then throwing them into garbage bins, having them suffocate or grinding them up alive. It's the most horrific thing animal agriculture could ever do to a baby animal. Another important fictional device is innovation. And what I mean is, when we genetically manipulate animals and selectively breed them for certain traits, like egg laying or milk production or flesh production, so they grow nice big breasts, when we do these kinds of things, we portray this, the scientific world and universities and all the institutions that are connected with this kind of study, they promote this as an incredible achievement, as a great advance, scientific advancement. Of course, when it's done to humans, when it was done to humans, it stopped because it's illegal. But like eugenics was a program of Nazi Germany of studying how to create humans that had more pure Aryan type of genes. That's the last time we really did it on humans, but we do it to other species and we think it's absolutely wonderful. So in the case of dairy cows, we have them producing 12 times more milk, up to 12 times more milk than their bodies were designed by nature to produce. In the case of hens bred for egg laying, we have them producing up to 250 to 300 eggs a year. And these are the heritage breeds too. I'm not talking about just the standard leghorn like that you see here. These birds were not designed for this. Their bodies were designed to lay 10 to 15 eggs a year maybe for the purpose of reproduction, like all other birds that lay eggs, right? So this is promoted to us as innovation. Another fictional device is euphemism. Euphemism is very important to the industries that exploit animals because it's the language that frames the issue for us in a positive light. So one of the famous words that I love, I call it the mother of all euphemisms, is what they call artificial insemination, a procedure that is about forcibly impregnating dairy cows and dairy goats by shoving one arm up a cow's rectum and shooting a semen gun into her vagina at the same time. And this is done repeatedly in her life. She then carries that baby for 9 months and then they have to try to help her have the pregnancy, so they're pulling the baby out. And then she goes through the cycle again and again until her body just breaks down and she can't do it anymore after 4 or 5 years maybe. So artificial insemination, In any other situation, if we were to do this to any other kind of animal, we would consider it rape, sexual violation, bestiality, or some other variant, right? But in animal agriculture, the law makes an exception and tells us that it's allowable because there's an economic interest involved. So imagine for a moment, consider that logic. Imagine applying that logic to any other thing in life, that there's something we want to do to someone, so we justify it because there's an economic benefit. It's not a moral argument. It's immoral to make an argument that way. But anyway, this is what it looks like. This diagram shows actually what has to be done. Another fictional device is called, I call it family. And of course, this is about misleading us into believe that animals are loved and cared for, just like the farmer's own children. And Domino's had a famous example of this that I had to use here. The cover of a Domino's pizza box for a while, I'm not sure if they still have this on there or not, but it shows the five cows and the names and faces of the cows that produce the cheese for the pizza that's in your box. Like, you're really going to believe that, right? Well, of course they know you, they know you're not going to believe that as a literal, but this is a metaphor. This is about using kind of an unconscious cultural mechanism to get us to believe that, yeah, there are faces and names to these animals, and they are giving this to us willingly. But if we look at the facts, it's quite clear that these calves that are born to dairy cows are worthless. They serve no purpose. The males have no purpose. The females are made pregnant simply because they have to lactate to produce milk. And the calves, whether female or male, are denied the one thing that they actually need the most, which is their own mother's milk, nurturing, and love, which they would normally get for the first 12 months of their lives if they were allowed to under normal conditions. But they're denied that in dairy farming. Their parents, their mothers are taken from them on day one. So it's important to see that animal farming is predicated on the denial of motherhood and the breaking up of families. That's how you get production to work. You have to break up the family unit in order to control production. Progress is what I throw in here because it's really close to innovation, but it's another example. It's kind of a historical example that I think is really important. Coming from Chicago, I have a personal connection with this. Because Chicago used to have a reputation as the quote-unquote hog butcher to the world. That was like the tagline for Chicago. People came to Chicago, and this is a postcard that you would get in a tourist a travel office, a travel agency or whatever. And one of the main attractions to visiting Chicago was visiting the Union Stockyards, which was the massive animal confinement and slaughter complex. It was the largest ever created in the world, and it was considered a great achievement of the Industrial Revolution. And another post-World War II fiction that still is very pervasive today is connecting strength and unity to eating animal products. Just like in this series of propaganda posters from the US government and the Dairy Council, showing that, you know, the melting pot, look at all the you know, the different ethnicities represented all around a big, you know, glass of soy milk, dairy milk. Freudian slip. Freudian slip there. Huge glass of cow's milk. The unifying force of our culture. Another fictional device is denigration. We use animal words as insults, like you're a chicken. Like in this example of A Rebel Without a Cause, the movie A Rebel Without a Cause from the 1960s, where the lead character, James Dean, in this scene, the pinnacle scene of the movie, he's taunted by his classmates. They're saying, you've got to play this stupid game where you drive your car off of a cliff and then you try to jump out just before it's going to go up. And they were taunting him as a chicken, and he finally he finally played the stupid game, and then when he went in the next scene, his parents are questioning him, why would you do this? You know, why would, you know, someone died in this? And he said, because I didn't want to be, you know, considered a chicken. So the reputation of a chicken as being a coward is central to this film. No one really walks away from this film ever thinking about that, but subconsciously, that's what the message is. And how horribly untrue that is, the fact that chickens are considered cowards, because they are some of the bravest birds that we know. If we study chickens in their natural habitat, and even some domestic chickens, we will find that mother hens will go, they will risk their lives, if necessary, to protect their young. And we know that, that females and males that are more dominant will protect the flock and do incredible. We had a hen named Danita that, when there was any sense of a predator threat, she would take the highest place in the yard, fly up to the highest place, and make certain calls to alert everyone else to take cover. And she was actually becoming a decoy, so that the predator attention would be on her and let everyone else escape. And so it was an incredible act of courage and altruism. Okay, so another device, I call it not wasting. And let me just preface this by saying wasting is a horrible, obviously we waste a lot of food in this country, and it's a horrible problem, but that's not what I'm talking about here. What I'm talking about is the idea of that if we eat the entire animal, if we don't waste any of the body parts, then suddenly we've arisen to some kind of ethical platform, and we're better than the people that buy the cellophane wrapped pieces of body parts in the store. Like, that makes us, you know, morally superior. And so this example is from the New York Times. It was a photo essay. This is real. This is a woman in Portland. Some of you might have seen this or read it. 2011, 2012. This is, by the way, yeah, that's a you actually just reminded me, this is based on a Norman Rockwell painting, the famous Thanksgiving painting with the turkey in the center and the family gathering around. They styled this photo very specifically around that. But this is real. This woman teaches slaughter classes in Portland, and she brought in a group of high school students to show them the whole process and then to teach them all about the different parts of the pig. And you know, what a wonderful experience this is to know where your food comes from. So they call it wasting, that the idea is that we're not wasting anything, therefore we're ethical. But I would argue that this isn't really about wasting, it's about culture. If it was really about wasting, we would not be wasting nutritious plant crops to feed farmed animals that we have no need to eat, and that we could otherwise feed to hungry poor people that have nothing to eat, right? And if it was really about wasting and not about culture, then following that logic, we should really eat all dead bodies, right? Why would we just eat chickens, turkeys, pigs, and cows when we wouldn't want to waste all these other animals like roadkill and you know, animals that we find that are dead? We would be eating them too. But of course we don't, because we don't consider them edible, because our culture dictates to us that only cows, turkeys, pigs, and chickens and a few other species are edible, and all the others are inedible and disgusting to eat. So it's about culture in this case, not wasting. And we talked a little bit about this earlier, touching on humane washing. I have an example here. I don't think you can talk about humane washing without referring to Temple Grandin, because she has become the iconic figure in the humane face of animal agriculture, an industry that kills 10 billion animals unnecessarily every year. And I don't think you can have a conversation about humane anything without mentioning Temple Grandin. Now, in 2006, HBO created a film by the same name, portraying Grandin as almost like a Mother Teresa to animals, right? Like, she's a heroine to animals, because she designed this slaughterhouse system that apparently allows the animals to be less stressed. But it only applies to cows, And it doesn't have anything to do with turkeys and chickens, which make up 98% of all the animals that are killed for food. It only applies to cows, and there's lots of critiques about whether it really does anything to help them. So there's a lot of debate about that. But regardless, the fact is that she is paid by the American Meat Institute and the National Turkey Federation and all of these trade, you know, these agriculture trade organizations that pay her because she represents a humane side of them, a facade. And so she's in their videos and in their literature, and she's a spokesperson on animal handling at their conferences. So she's ubiquitous in putting a humane face to the industry. History is often used as a fictional device, like in the Smithsonian cover story called How the Chicken Conquered the World. And this was in 2012, and this is by someone who is a historian and who's well respected and did an elaborate story, but the story is about turning a victim into a great hero. And this is something that makes us feel good because it makes us think that just because we were able to make an animal flourish and we can breed them 300 a second in this country, that makes them heroes. No, it just makes them worse victims, right? Misogyny is another fictional device. And this is about how we assert male superiority and reinforcing the submissive, servile role of female animals. We call them baby makers, or egg machines, or milk producers. Here's an example of a trade ad that's for a pharmaceutical product that helps cows produce a lot more milk, right? I don't know if you can read this, but the headline for the ad is, "If she can't stay pregnant, what else will she do?" So this male-dominated industry is using the same kind of sexism and misogyny as they were using against women, not too long ago, when women should be home barefoot and pregnant. And now they're using it, on females of other species. it's crazy. But the fact is that, yes, it's a male-dominated industry. There are very few, the percentage of women is very low. But it involves total control over female reproduction. That's very important. It involves total control over her ovaries, over her mammary glands, over her offspring, and ultimately over her life. And the yin and yang of this is masculinity and the perceptions of masculinity that are presented to us through popular culture. Remember, this isn't just about advertising. This is about literature and popular culture as a whole. And films, iconic films like Rocky, factor very powerfully into this equation. This idea that eating animals makes us feel stronger psychologically and physiologically, and more powerful and more confident and more in control. Naturalism is a fictional device that appeals, in this got milk ad, to our yearning for maternal affection and love. And it suggests very strangely, at least to me, if you're on the side of, like, you've seen through this already and you look at this, it's very strange how it suggests that, breastfeeding your own children is the same as, like, drinking breast milk from another species. But the fact is that even calves are weaned off of their mother's milk after 1 year and they move on to solid food. And we're the only species that drinks the breast milk of another animal, even though the idea of drinking our own mother's breast milk disgusts us. So our culture has dictated that absurdity and contradiction in our thinking. Sexualization is an important... I picked a really bizarre, offbeat example of this because you've all seen, sex is used to sell everything today, right? You see it all the time. to try to sell all different kinds of products. But this was a weird example that I found from Modern Farmer. Does anyone know Modern Farmer magazine or heard of it? It's a kind of hipster, urbanite type of farming magazine that you find at Whole Foods, places like Whole Foods. And it's usually like, you know, real progressive. They think they're real progressive stories. But in this case, this is a piece they did, a very elaborate piece, flamboyant even, called Painting the Farm Red, The Chicken Slaughtering Pinup Girls of Marion Acres. And I just want to read you the introduction to this piece, if you can't see it. It says, at Marion Acres, we thoughtfully raise chickens on pasture to provide our customers with healthy and well-cared-for meat. Once a year, friends and family of Marion Acres gather up all the girls and do what we like to call our ladies' chicken harvest. All the ladies get dressed in vintage clothes, pinup-inspired hair, and of course, red lipstick to do our butchering. We couldn't think of a better way to knock them dead. I know. Trivialization is similar to denigration, but in a way different. It's about turning animals into a laughingstock. If we can laugh at them, we don't have to take them seriously. We don't have to give them any serious moral consideration. I took this photo just a couple months ago at a new pork a barbecue restaurant near my house in Chicago, in the neighborhood where I live, which is, I thought, was a perfect example of this. A few more. Glorification. Anyone seen? This is a Whole Foods Market campaign that came out a few years ago called We Are Earthlings. You may have seen it. Many different campaign, like one campaign, but many different visuals, and this was one of them, of the Good Shepherd. It was a perfect example of me of how popular culture turns farmers sometimes into saviors or like Christ-like good shepherds, like in this case. And it connects, it makes this whole idea of animal farming seem kind of, it deifies it in a way. It gives us reverence for it. Reductionism, this is the second to the last one. Cage-free, pasture-raised, free-range. These are reductionist ploys to get us to think that if we just have one simple change to a very complex problem, the problem is solved. But it's not. Getting animals out of cages is, of course, one important aspect of the suffering that they endure, but it does not solve the problem. Authenticity. Sorry, I lied. There's a couple more. authenticity, like this real dairy product logo, which has been around for decades, suggests that animal products are the real thing, and anything that tries to mimic it is just a fake. But the process of raising and breeding animals and slaughtering them today is the most unreal and artificial process imaginable. Visibility is my last one. Sorry for the difficult image. But we talked about invisibility, and I brought that up because it's very important to Melanie Joy's position on why we eat animals. But visibility, the inverse, also plays a very important role in fictionalizing why we should eat animals. And I know it's contradictory, but then these aren't all, you know, perfectly in line. There's some that contradict each other, and that's not my fault. That's just I'm just putting out there what I see. In the case of visibility, what I mean is that by witnessing, by knowing where our food comes from, we claim that that it gives us some kind of moral superiority. So the idea of witnessing or partaking in violence against animals elevates our ethical status, right? Okay, so I just showed you some of the fictions, which are part of a larger work of mine. It's actually a book project where I go into more in depth in all of these, and I introduce quite a few more. But I'd like to leave you with what I think is actually something that we as people who care and would like to see change in our world, a positive example of how corporate branding can be used and how it's borrowing things about social change that are very positive. And so I think we can learn something from Apple's Think Different campaign, which came out in the mid-90s. And this kind of has a personal connection for me because I was a graphic artist in the 90s when Apple was like crumbling and the media was saying, oh, Windows is going to take over Apple and all that. And we were petrified because we really thought like Microsoft was the devil. So we didn't want to go to Windows. It was like the most uncool thing possible. And then Apple introduced their Think Different campaign, and they adorned whole sides of buildings with huge portraits of visionary people like Gandhi and Salvador Dali. And we thought, well, that's beautiful, but that's preaching to the choir. Like, why are they, if they're trying to increase their market share, then why are they appealing to us? They should have a different kind of campaign that appeals to middle America, which is the market they want to sell to, right? Well, what we didn't realize is that what Apple was doing was very premeditated and very strategic. They were launching a major rebranding, a major comeback by appealing to their core base of support. Because they knew that if they could empower us as their cult following, that we would go out and become their brand champions and tell everyone that this product, this brand has a story that it's about the underdog and the visionary and the creative spirit in all of us. And we would go out and do that and they would become successful. And in fact, it worked. The strategy worked phenomenally when you consider what Apple is today, right? And I believe that this can serve as a template for our own work as activists or advocates, whatever term you'd like to use, in the sense that we can focus, we can target our audience to a sympathetic audience. Like, for example, what they call the early majority is about, they say, 38% of the population, which is sympathetic to our cause. They're not necessarily on board, they're not on our team yet, but they're sympathetic. And we could create cause champions like Apple created brand champions to spread their message about their brand for free. So that's what I'd like to leave you with, thinking about how we can target our message and what we care about to people that are somewhere in the spectrum and not somewhere way off and impossible to reach. So thank you very much, and I'll be happy to answer questions. Yes?
So I'm thinking about this last killing in the school up in Oregon, and I'm willing to venture that some of these mass killers are vegan.
Right. You're probably right. Yeah. I hope so. I hope you're right. Yes. I do, yes. I've been trying to do more of it. I'm based in Chicago, as I think I mentioned, but I'll be at Chicago Vegan Mania, which is Chicago's largest vegan festival of the year, attracts about 5,000 to 6,000 people. That's next Saturday. I'll be in Portland in November for the Northwest Veg Fest, speaking on 2 days there, one about a new presentation on chickens, and then I'm giving this one on one of the other days. Trying to do colleges and universities and schools. So, yeah, a little bit of traveling.
Is there still about 3 more minutes? Can we show that last slide again?
Okay.
The one that said focusing on the target audience, more sympathetic?
I can, yeah. I can.
Well,
Yes.
Hi, Robert.
How are you? Nice to see you too, David.
Your piece on the reductionism reminded me where I live up in Sonoma County, where I go shopping at Oliver's Market. They're now promoting a new meat called Mindful Meat.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the, so they have this huge banner out in front of the store. I mean, it's enormous. And one of the things that it says in there is that Mindful Meat is sustainably raised. And it got me wondering, like, it's such a nonsense word. It doesn't really mean anything. And because anything about sustainably raised broccoli or artichokes, but so it just struck me as a marketing technique.
Yes, and it's really the most important thing we face. I think the humane movement is really, it's the way the meat industry, the animal agriculture industry, is trying to intercept the discussion away from veganism and back towards meat to try to intercept that audience back. So it's very important that we understand and address that, and it's going to grow and grow, and the market's going to continue to grow, so we're going to need to really kind of challenge it whenever we can. Yes?
I just want to add on to the point you mentioned about chicken. We used to raise chicken, and we raise them from young, and when you raise them from young, they actually, as they get older, they actually like to be peppered. And every time we'd go back to our yard, they'd literally jump into your hands, and they want to be peppered. But now it's another group of chicken. We didn't touch them with their young. They did not want to be touched. It's almost like a protest to be touched when they were adults. So they have the same traumas that children, human children, would have if they are not touched. And the second point I wanted to just point out was regarding milk. I'd like to mention this. I think heard it from Michael Greger. He made a point that cow's milk is intended to convert a 65-pound calf into a 300-pound cow. And he refers to it as a calf growth fluid. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we call it. And once you call it calf growth fluid, suddenly it's not that appetizing.
Well, we could call it baby formula. Sometimes I just call it calf, baby
formula. And then they're surprised that so many people are approaching 300 pounds now. So that's intended,
yeah. Right. To your point about chickens too, I'd like to say that we've had rescues that were very mistreated. And they were very apprehensive about being handled, but they learned to love companionship and affection later when they learned how to trust. And it's amazing to me how some of the chickens that we've rescued are so open to trusting us, because if it was humans, I think it would be a lot more difficult. We've had chickens that have been terribly treated, have been, escaped from slaughterhouses and were injured and were found in a forest preserve in the middle of winter. I mean, the worst conditions you could possibly think of. And they're, imagine the fear and that and all that experience. And then to rescue them and to have them just kind of always want to be near you, like by your feet, or, jump into your lap if you let them, or it's really humbling to see someone, respond that way after being so horribly treated. It's humbling.
It just shows how smart they are.
It
that they can pick up on the energy.
It shows how socially intelligent they are. Incredibly so. Yeah. I have another presentation on chickens that's all about chickens and our rescues.
Thank you for coming.